Good morning. We're celebrating my dad's homegoing today.
Today, on behalf of the Johnson family, this service of remembrance and celebration for Reverend Dale Johnson. They want you to know that your presence here today, the words that you've uttered, the hugs that you've given, the calls you made, the cards you sent, the prayers you have offered, they are so appreciative of those for that. They are very, very grateful. I'm going to switch just the order a little bit this morning before I give you a brief history of Dale. I'm going to turn the mic down, and then we're going to pray. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, Almighty God, creator of our dying bodies and the lover of our undying souls, we bow before you with reverent hearts. You have gathered here today to remember a godly man. Thank you for the 83 years you have given to him and for his impact, not only in our lives, but the many who could not be here because of distance or illness or weather or because they've already departed this life. I think that at a time such as this, each of us is reminded of our own mortality. Isaiah said that we're like grass. He said the grass withers and the flowers fall. Solomon pointed out that generations come and generations go. And even though we live to 83, in light of eternity, life is short. Help each one of us to spend our lives fulfilling your plan and purpose for each of us. Father, while we are here on this earth, life can be difficult. And Jesus said that in this world we would have problems, trials, tribulation, but that he would be with us during those times to help us through them. I'm so thankful that you are Jehovah Jireh, the God who provides. You have provided that which Dale needed all these years, and you're even now providing for him in his heavenly home. Thank you, Father. My request this day is that you speak your message to each one of us as we listen to the scriptures wonderfully written, and the thoughts tenderly shared, and the music beautifully played and sung. May we be lifted above the darkness and distress of this world into the comfort and peace of your presence through Jesus Christ our Lord. And may we leave refreshed in spirit, encouraged in our hearts, and prepared to face the coming days. This we pray in Jesus' name. It has been said that a man's life consists of 20 years of his mother asking him where he's going, 40 years of his wife asking him where he's been, and 1 hour at a funeral where everybody's wondering, where is he going? We don't have to wonder where Dale is going or where he has gone. It was at the age of 8 that Dale asked Jesus Christ into his life to be his personal Savior. And it was 10 years later that he asked Christ, he rededicated his life, and he gave his life wholly to the Lord. And it was at that point that he gave up some of his bad habits that he had had. He stopped going with the girl that he had been going with because she didn't like his Christianity. And it was at that time that God called Dale into become a pastor, which his mother had been praying for. And Dale said that often he would come home from an activity and his mother would be sitting at the kitchen table praying for him out loud. And one of her requests was that he would become a pastor. After the Lord called him into full-time ministry, he began preparing himself by living in Northeast Minneapolis with his sister Artis and her family. He was able to attend Northwestern Bible College. And the Lord knew that he needed a job, and so he provided that at Dayton's, even though there were many, many applicants. And it was at Dayton's that he met Ernie Lindahl, and Ron Burgrist, and Marv Nixon, who became lifelong friends. He not only worked with them at Dayton's, he went with them to Northwestern. I was about 13 or 14 when I first met Dale. He, after Northwestern, he went to Central Baptist Theological Seminary. And while he was in seminary, he became the youth pastor of the church that I attended. Having known him since 13 or 14, you know that I've known him a long time. By the way, Dale was indirectly responsible for me meeting and marrying my wife, Sandra, who shares the same name as his wife. Dale met his Sandra informally at the end of a Sunday evening service. They were introduced and they shook hands. But on their first date was when they went roller skating. And that's when things really started rolling. When asked, "What was the attraction for you, Dale, with Sandra?" he said, "She was sweet and had looks." Sandra and Dale have been married since July 6th, 1963. Let me just tell you a little story of when they were married. They were married on a Saturday evening, and before they started their honeymoon, they went to a Miller family picnic the next day. Now, Miller is Sandra's maiden name, so they went to the family picnic and they opened the wedding presents. And after that, this is Sunday, they were really starting the honeymoon on Monday, they stopped at Artis and Harlow's place in Northeast Minneapolis to spend the night. Well, just for the fun of it, Artis and Harlow got an alarm clock, put it in this metal pan, set it for early in the morning so that they would start off with a bang. After their honeymoon started with a bang, their marriage was a roaring success. Sandra and Dale were married for 53 years. And that sweet woman who has looks stood beside him in a united team through four passports. As most long-lasting marriages, they had their share of joys and their share of difficulties. As many of you know, Dale started showing signs of dementia in 2005. And that is a most difficult disease, particularly for the caregiver. And let me say this to you, Sandra. Your love and caring were exceptional for Dale, outstanding. And you are an example and an inspiration for the rest of us here. God bless you. Now, some of the things I've just shared with you about Dale come from a little booklet that Dale and Sandra's daughter Stephanie had given Dale on Father's Day 1998. It's called A Father's Legacy. And the purpose of the book was for her dad to write in there answers to questions each month. Questions like, what did you enjoy doing most as a child? Did your mother work outside of the home? What were your early remembrances of church? What was your first date? And it's a book that, when filled out, reveals the family history, childhood memories, humorous incidents, and meaningful traditions in a person's life. Now, I just want to read you the presentation page from Stephanie to her dad. Dad, thank you for all the wonderful memories, for your wisdom, guidance, and love. I always knew, without a doubt, that you loved me and wanted the best for me. The legacy you have left for me is one I cherish and will always remember. Thank you for your Christian values and leadership, which are the most important keys in raising children. So you've told me. You were not only a pastor, but a prophet with many other gifts. The Lord blessed you with so much. Thank you for sharing them with me. I love you, Dad. You're my hero. All my love, Stephanie. And Dale's love for his wife and daughter were as obvious as their love for him. Let me just share a personal note. Dale, as I said, was the youth pastor, and he was, when I was growing up, and he was the best youth pastor that I ever had. He was a jokester. He was fun, silly, crazy. I guess you got to be that to be a youth pastor. You fit that bill. But he loved to tease, and he loved to mess around with you. And Dale was just great at planning activities. You know, we didn't have any fun activities like they have today, but he planned every Saturday night we had something. We'd go into Souls Harbor, I remember, and we would have fun activities. I can remember Singspirations. That's a word you don't hear much anymore. But we would do things like all night or New Year's Eve parties, and he just made it so much fun. But I remember going into Skid Row with him, and we would go in on a Saturday night, and we would have a service for those who were less fortunate than we were, and we would serve them food and so on. And he showed how to love the down and out during those times. And he helped develop leadership skills in many of us. Our youth group was never bigger or better, thanks to Dale. But as funny and as fun as he was, he could be just as serious when he was talking to you about the Lord or your walk. He vividly displayed his love for God and for teenagers. He was a real encourager. And what do teenagers need more than anything? I think it's encouragement. Now, if we had an open mic today, which we're not going to, because you would keep us here all day, telling of the blessings that Dale has brought to your life. But what a great man of God he was, and what a wonderful legacy he leaves. Thursday was Thanksgiving. And we give thanks today for a life well lived.
This song is all about heaven and what it's going to be like. There's not going to be any crying anymore. There's not going to be any suffering anymore. We're going to be able to rejoice and celebrate just like I know my dad's doing right now. Hopefully, but we are rejoicing that my dad is in heaven. So I'm hoping you all can help us out with that today, too. What an amazing man my father was. I was lucky enough to be the only one who could call him that. Since I was adopted, he would always say how special I was because I was chosen and everyone else just had to get what they got. So. Never once did I question my dad's love for me, for sure. He was never too busy or too tired for me. He was my biggest fan and encourager. There was nothing that we couldn't accomplish or figure out together. He wasn't my only biggest fan, but also Eric's and his three grandkids. He thought his grandkids were the brightest, most talented, best-looking kids out there, which they are. Sometimes it would get a little annoying. I'm sorry for those of you that had to put up with that, but he didn't care. He had the biggest heart, and he loved us all so much. He was the most generous person I have ever known. One of his favorite things to do was go Black Friday shopping, downtown Dayton's, go through the 8th floor. I really missed that yesterday, every time Black Friday comes around. And my dad hasn't been able to do that the last few years, but he loved to do that. But one time when we were down there, he surprised me and brought me to the fur vault and bought me a mink coat, which he could not afford. But he didn't care. He figured out a way to make it happen, and it was one of my most memorable Christmases, and he made me feel like the luckiest girl ever. He thoroughly enjoyed buying all of us gifts. Sometimes he tried to buy us things we didn't even want. Like, one time he tried to talk all the kids into getting cowboy boots, and the boys were like, we don't want those. We want Heelys. So he ended up getting a Heelys. Sierra, though, got the pink cowboy boots. Gift giving was definitely a love language of his. He was just so much fun. He always wanted to go places and see things and experience life and just enjoy life. Every year we went to the state fair. He couldn't wait to take all of us and buy us footlongs and Minnesota Gopher gear. He'd be like, go Gophers today, you better win. It made him so happy. He also did so many things for other people behind the scenes that nobody ever knew. He was such a hard worker. He would mow the lawn at the church and then our house, and then our church also owned like other property, and then we'd go to the gas station. We'd get pop, and then we'd drive by all of them and look at what a great job he did. Now, doesn't that look nice? So, but he loved doing it, and he took pride in it. He was a true example of the kind of Christian we should be. He accepted people for who they were, and he loved everyone no matter what. There were a few times my friends and I, Nicole, would end up in my dad's office for something that we did, and he wouldn't even tell their parents. He thought it was punishment enough that they actually had to end up in his office. So
praise
it worked out great for them, not so much me. Anyway, I didn't always like being a pastor's kid. I hated that label, but the older I got, the more I realized how lucky I was to have a dad that was a pastor and the legacy that he left, and a legacy of someone who gave his whole heart and soul to spreading the gospel of Jesus. Not everyone can have their dad baptize them or marry them and baptize their kids. So pretty cool. He taught me that success in life wasn't about how much money you made or what kind of car you drove, but what was in your heart and what you could do to further the kingdom of heaven. And I know he's in home with his Lord and Savior today, and I pray that each and every one of us are here today can have that same hope of heaven, because he would want to see all of you there. So whenever we would go on vacation and get home, my dad would have this saying that was in his own version of Swedish. So sorry, Fran, I'm not going to say it right. But he would say, "Vat va bra, but him of a best," which meant, it's great to go away, but home is the best. And And well, Dad, you are finally home. Mm-hmm. We love and miss you.
So, I'll go.
This is Sierra.
Yep.
His only granddaughter.
So, unfortunately, I did not get as much time with my grandpa when he was well as the rest of my family. But one special thing I remember him doing was holding our hands and squeezing it 3 times, which meant, I love you. However, I did get to spend a lot more time with my grandpa when he was sick. I would go over to Grandma and Grandpa's house every morning before elementary school. Most of that time was spent with one-sided conversations, as he wouldn't say much more than a few words. But the few words he would say to me before I left for school every morning were, I love you, sweetheart. As my grandpa's dementia progressed, he began to say fewer and fewer words, which ultimately led to him not speaking at all. I had missed my grandpa, the real him, and most of all, I missed his I love yous. One evening, my grandma needed someone to help with grandpa, and I was fortunate enough to be able to spend time with him that day. It was one of his few days left on earth, and at this point, my grandpa was still not talking and now barely opening his eyes. Just as I was about to leave, I grabbed his hand and said, I love you, grandpa. I wasn't expecting anything back, but this time, he was trying really hard to keep his eyes open. He squeezed my hand and kept doing it over and over again. It was like he really needed to tell me something. And finally, I realized that they were coming in threes. And he wasn't just squeezing my hand, he was telling me, I love you. I am so grateful that I got to be there with him that day, and I thank God for that special moment with my grandpa. I love you, grandpa, and I know that you are in a place now where there's no more suffering or pain. You are home.
When I was trying to determine what I wanted to pursue as an occupation, it was important to focus on a career that would make a difference in people's lives. And eventually I landed on teaching, figuring that I'd have a captivated audience of about 200 different students each year. The older I get, the more I look at, for, admire, and am fascinated by observing what makes people tick. How do they interact with others? What thrills them? What upsets them? What frightens them? And most importantly, what do they value? One can learn everything he needs to know about someone by looking at their checkbook and their calendar. How do they invest their time? How do they spend their money? Are they a people person? Little did I know when I spotted that beautiful blonde across the college gymnasium in 1990 that she would not only become my best friend, but becoming her husband would also include an invaluable bonus package, becoming part of Dale and Sandra Johnson's family. I was unaware of what jackpot I had stumbled upon at the time, inheriting second parents that were such selfless role models. I quickly realized how wondrously God had orchestrated Stephanie's adoption, guiding her into their lives. She has truly been blessed to grow up in such a godly home. Both Dale and Sandra are people. I could talk for hours about Sandra, but no one needs to look further than the selfless, unconditional love and perpetual care that she's given Dale for the past 14 years that were robbed from his life. Simply put, she's an angel. Today we celebrate the life and the godly legacy of a truly amazing man. I feel sincerely honored to have been able to witness his lifestyle through the lens of his son-in-law. I could not have imagined a better mentor of what it looks like and the sacrifice that it requires to become a people person. I'm deeply saddened that his 3 grandchildren never got to see the wonder of Dale Johnson that I've witnessed. I have not encountered another person more generous and selfless than Dale. In the 30 years that I've been a part of his family, I've always witnessed him putting others first. I've never once heard him complain, and there's never been a challenge that was insurmountable or unsolvable. Ever the optimist, our family has heard his encouraging voice and seen him tackle situations proving that anything is possible. But perhaps the most important lesson that I've learned from him is that I should never be too busy or too tired to help others. Stephanie and my kids would no doubt argue that I have yet to learn the lesson since I go to bed so early. But believe me, the message is sinking in. Dale has never been too tired to help someone else, and yes, he's been tired. Yet somehow, he's always found the strength to push the exhaustion aside in order to put others first. When I first met him, he pastored Little Falls Baptist Church, took care of all the maintenance responsibilities inside and out of the church, was on the board at Pillsbury College, and had 3 part-time jobs. Despite juggling this exhausting schedule, he always found a way to put everyone else's. Was on the board at Pillsbury College, and had 3 part-time jobs. Despite juggling this exhausting schedule, he always found a way to put everyone else's needs before his. I could share countless examples and ways that I've witnessed his generosity, but I want to just share one story that encapsulates the kind of selfless character that Dale lived out every day. When we were first married, we lived in a small apartment in Little Canada. The first winter brought a bitter 3-week cold snap. We didn't have a garage, so during that time, because of the extreme cold, Stephanie and I had a difficult time starting our cars. And I remember setting an alarm every 3 hours to wake up in the middle of the night and go start both of the cars and warm them up, hoping that they'd start in the morning. One cold evening, the strategy finally failed, and Dale and Sandra thought nothing of driving from Uppsala after a long day of their own to get our cars running again. Dale knew I was capable of figuring it out on my own, but he wanted to be part of the solution, and he dropped everything to help us. This is the kind of person that Dale was for everyone that was fortunate enough to cross paths with him. I can only hope that one day, a fraction of this integrity and character and generosity that he has is part of my life. He was the ultimate people person.
Jeepers, this one's going to be tough. Okay. I just wanted to share a quick story of me, my grandpa, and my grandma. We went to Little Falls, and we were just looking at all the places they, like the church and their old house. And then he brought me fishing, and he had a lot of fishing gear, and like 4 tackle boxes and a bunch of poles. So it seemed like he knew what he was doing. So he brought me down to the river, and he didn't really give me much help, but I think he just kind of thought it was funny to watch me struggle. But I was like, so is this how you put it on? Looks good to me. Saying stuff like that. Am I casting in the right spot here? Yeah, you are. And I finally caught one, but unfortunately it flopped off into the rocks, and now that I think about it, if I did try and take it off the hook or something, I don't think just grab it and take it off the hook. You'll be fine, trust me, I do it all the time. But yeah, that's my story. Shorter than the rest of it, write it down, I'm sorry. Definitely a family man. Every time we were around the table, he just brightened up everyone's mood. My grandfather was always smiles and laughs. I actually only remember him getting upset twice. One time, I was younger, Isaac and I locked the door to the bathroom from the inside, so he had to take the hinges off the door, which was the first time I learned how to do that. And I also learned the full meaning of the word licking. The other time was when we were eating at a restaurant that didn't serve Diet Pepsi. Some of my best memories with my grandpa were going to Sparky's and knowing I could order whatever I wanted. Nothing was off the table. After the meal, we would go down to the river and feed the ducks with the leftover bread that we had left. And I didn't understand it then, but those were some of the most cherished times I had alone with my grandparents. He was godly and very determined, whether that being leading people to Christ, working one of his many jobs, or being the first one to the foot-long hot dog stand at the State Fair. The Great Minnesota Get-Together was a time that I appreciated with my grandpa, and it was where he illuminated with happiness. While old age was catching up to him, that did not slow him down, literally. If you couldn't keep an eye on him at the fair, he'd be one block ahead of you at the next food stand. Can it all. Grandpa Dale loved unconditionally. He was a role model, showing ultimate selflessness while finding pure joy in giving everything he could to others. His love language was giving gifts, and I learned to help him show love often. I'm truly filled with joy and content knowing that my grandfather is in heaven, pain-free, living his new permanent life with his Creator.
We invite you to stand, worship the Lord together, and we'll sing His great faithfulness.
I'm Kathy Tokley. This is my husband Pete. He's here for moral support. And I am Dale and Sandra's niece. My first conscious memory of Uncle Dale was when I was about 4 years old. Dale was attending Northwestern College and he lived with my family. Now he and my dad loved my mom's cooking and baking. So sometimes my mom would hide her baked bread or cookies or pie so that others could have a taste of them besides my dad and Dale. Now my dad could never find them, but Dale always found them. And my mom had some pretty good hiding places. Dale had his own names for things, places, and people. You heard about the lickin'. Yeah, he had his own way of calling things. Well, Paulette and I had special names that only he used. Cashy Bashy and Polly Wally Hoo Hoo. Those were our names. We got to know Dale's buddies, too, while he was living with us. Bergie, Ron Berquist, would come over driving his old Mercedes-Benz that had been shipped from Germany and give us rides in the rumble seat. We were envied by all the neighborhood kids. His friend Ernie came over too. He teased us to the point my mom would have to intervene to keep her sanity. Those men are wonderful, godly friends to this day. Dale would buy us special outfits and other things from Dayton's. I especially remember, Paulette, the matching red sweaters and gray wool skirts. Many nights, Dale would tuck us in and we would have prayer with him. We were so lucky. When Dale went to seminary, he lived with my grandparents. But we were still a big part of his life. He brought us to vacation Bible schools with him, and when he filled a pulpit, he took us along as his special music. I learned from Dale at a young age that there is, as the song says, joy in serving Jesus. As Paulette and I grew, Dale was like a second dad to us. He always gave good, godly advice. One thing I remember him telling us, and I think he told the same thing to Sandra and Diane, was to make sure we got a good education beyond high school. Thank you, Uncle Dale. Paulette went to beauty school and had a rewarding occupation doing men's hair. I went to college to get my teaching certificate and had over 25 years of teaching. Thanks, Uncle Dale. Paulette and I visited Dale and Sandra many times when they were pastoring at First Baptist Church in Medelia, Minnesota. We met friends there that are still our friends, even though we don't see them very often. Whenever we showed up, he had jobs for us to participate in, some church-related, and others, well, Sandra, I remember freezing a trunk load of corn with you. When I attended Pillsbury Baptist Bible College, Dale had me come to his church in Medelia on extension on the weekends. Again, there I was able to be a part of ministry. Then I transferred with my friend Connie to Mankato State College, which, by the way, is only a half-hour drive from Medelia. Dale and Sandra invited us to live with them. We did so for 3 years. Dale and Sandra became our second set of parents. Dale was Connie's Lowell number two, and he was my Harlan number two. We had times there of sadness, times of sweet fellowship, and times of a lot of fun. Actually, hilarity. Dale was so much fun. He jumped rope with us. He did all kinds of funny things with us. Connie and I think, learned as much living with Dale and Sandra as we did in college. Dale had to rein us in at times, though. Many townspeople thought we were his daughters. So we experienced, Stephanie, being preacher's kids. Not always real fun. One thing we learned not to do from Uncle Dale was to drive up and down Main Street in Medelia in our robes and wearing rollers in our hair. He said, no more. Dale liked to prove he could do certain things. So one evening, we fit three cars into his two-car garage. We did it. Once. But we did it. After I graduated from college, there were no teaching jobs to be found. Dale and Sandra were adopting a baby girl, and Sandra had a teaching job nearby until Thanksgiving. So they asked if I would come and help Dale care for that sweet baby girl, Stephanie. We worked well together as a team, bathing her, feeding her, changing her, and playing with her. It really prepared me to be a mom someday. On Friday nights, we'd go to New Ulm, where Sandra was teaching, and treat ourselves to supper at the local fast food place. And after Thanksgiving, I had a job in the Moundsview schools. Dale said that it was God who worked all that out. Thank you, Peter. When Paulette married Randy, and I married Pete, Dale officiated. I still remember the verse he gave to me when I married Pete. Psalm 37:4. Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Dale extended his fun and ministry to my children. Steve had stayed at Dale and Sanders in Little Falls during Vacation Bible School. And he came home and he reported to me that Uncle Dale went to the gas station, but not for gas. He went to get pop. Steve thought that was really great. So you can see Dale was a part of my life throughout my life. It was sad to see the vibrant, funny, loving Dale slowly disappear over the last 15 years. Sandra, we appreciate you and your wonderful care of our brother and uncle. You're an angel. We can only imagine how Dale felt when he saw his Savior, Jesus, face to face. And the reunion he's had with Grandpa and Grandma, Lyle, and my mom, Artis. They have gone to the mansions in heaven that Jesus said in John 14 that he has prepared for them and for us who have trusted him as our Savior.
My dad and Dale were friends since my first memory was about age 4. He couldn't be here, his own health is declining, he's 87 now, and they're in Florida. So Stephanie and Sandy asked me if I would come and read a little letter that he had kind of done up a little tribute to Dale. So, my friend, I first got acquainted with Dale at a time when both of us were pastors and we had teens from our churches attending a summer Bible camp called Camp Victory. He was the director, and I was asked to be in charge of doing the purchasing of food and supplies for the 3 weeks of camp. We spent much time working together that summer, and our favorite part of the day was when we would get a late night snack in the kitchen when all the teens were in bed. Go figure. Years later, we pastored churches that were about 20 minutes apart. Dale was in Medelia, and I was in New Ulm. Our church had a Christian school, and several students from his church were in our school. During those years, we enjoyed many long coffee breaks, which of course contributed to our deepening and long-lasting friendship. We had so many shared joys and fun experiences through the years. Many of them have already been mentioned here. Camp Victory, Camp Coronas, which was a yearly summer family camp where Pat and I shared a cabin with Dale and Sandy. A trip to Washington, D.C. and New York City, many winter trips to Florida, we even purchased a small home in Kissimmee together, trips to Breezy Point, meeting every year the day after Thanksgiving by the air door so we could go to the 8th floor and do the Christmas display together. And then probably their favorite, I think ranks way up there, State Fair has been mentioned, but for years my parents and Dale and Sandy had a camper or a motorhome that they put on the State Fair campgrounds, and they'd stay several days and go to the State Fair together. My dad hung on to that State Fair tradition even after Dale could no longer communicate much or walk. The last couple of years they went together, my dad pushed him in a wheelchair. My dad's health wasn't the best by then, as he had neuropathy in his feet and he was in much pain, but he still wanted to do that with his friend. I must not omit the joy we shared with Dale and Sandy at the time of the adoption of their Stephanie. I think Camp Coronas was the first time we saw Stephanie. Again, a shared cabin, this time with a new baby. She lit up their lives like nothing else could. She continued to do that along with her husband Eric and those three wonderful grandkids. Stephanie, you brought so much joy to your dad. He loved you so much, and you were perfect in his eyes. Nothing describes friendship quite like the verses from Proverbs. A friend loves at all times. A man that has friends must show himself to be friendly. And there is a friend that sticks closer than a brother. Dale, through the past 50 plus years, has been more than a brother in Christ. He's been my very close friend. We've been able to share our innermost thoughts and feelings with each other without any hesitation. Dale's health declined, and we couldn't do all the things or go all the places that we used to. But during one of our last visits, I said to him, "The best is still ahead of us. We can anticipate some long visits in heaven someday." He couldn't communicate much, but he agreed when I said that to him. No matter what the occasion, his presence lit it up. He had a great capacity to love. First, he loved his Lord. Then he loved his sweetheart and best friend, Sandy. He loved his beautiful daughter, Stephanie, and her family. Dale was a people lover, and he loved leading others to Christ. He loved being a pastor, and he loved his host of friends. I feel very blessed to be Dale's personal and longtime friend. I called my dad the day that Dale went to heaven. Of course, he had mixed emotions. He said it wasn't supposed to be this way. I was supposed to go first. I'm older. I was supposed to be the one greeting him in heaven. Now, he will be the one greeting me. My dad wrote this a while back, knowing that it was possible that Dale might go before him because of his declining health. A couple days ago, he sent a little follow-up note. "Since hearing that Dale's health was worsening, I've been praying that he would not have to go to a nursing home. God answered that prayer and took him home to heaven. As I expressed to Sandy when we learned of his homegoing, I'm experiencing joy and grief. I miss my friend, but I rejoice that I will see him again in heaven."
I invite you to stand. So we think about Dale today and talk about him. Knowing his love for Jesus and his commitment to Jesus, I know that he would want us to give glory to God for God's amazing grace and his love, which is truly an amazing thing.
Thank you. Having lived out east for 18 years, I'm somewhat familiar with Black Baptist Church in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Once a year, they have Student Recognition Day. And the old Black people in that church just love that day because they grew up in a time when bright Black people didn't have a chance. And they became elevator operators, and laundrymen, doing menial jobs, porters, scrubbing. Even though they had IQs that would have allowed them to become doctors, lawyers, professionals. But their children and their grandchildren are doing it. And they have this student recognition day when the students will come up on the platform and one will say, I'm at MIT studying engineering. And another will say, I'm at Harvard studying political science. I'm at Yale, and on it goes. And the old folks just sit there and groan. And there's this groan that goes through the congregation as they sit there and say, my, 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 my. And you just hear all these my, my's as they bask in the glory of a new generation that is doing what they would have done had they lived in another kind of America. When the students were finished on the platform and were sitting in the front rows, the pastor got up. And he looked at them and he said, children, he always called them this, children, you're going to die. You don't think you're going to die. You're going to die. They're going to drop you in a hole, throw dirt over your face, and go back to the church and have potato salad. That's what's going to happen. And when you're dead, there's only two questions. Did you leave behind a title? Or the other question. Did you leave behind a testimony? Now, I'm not saying you can't have both, but you've got to decide which one is the most important one. A title or a testimony? He said, are you going to be buried with the inscription over the tomb, here lies Charlie Jones, PhD, president of the Rotary Club, and a lot of other titles? Or is there going to be people standing around your grave giving testimonies of how you affected their lives and blessed them, changed them in the name of Jesus Christ? Are you going to have titles or testimonies? Many did, but only a Black Baptist preacher can do. He went through the entire Bible in 10 minutes. Now, white Baptist preachers can't do that. This guy started in Genesis and he went through Revelation in one smooth move. He said, there was Pharaoh and there was Moses. Pharaoh had the title. Moses had the testimonies. There was Elijah and there was Jezebel. Jezebel was the queen. She had the title. But Elijah had the testimonies. He said there was Daniel and there was Nebuchadnezzar. Nebuchadnezzar was the ruler of Babylon. He had the title, but Daniel had the testimonies. He went all the way through that thing. And he ended by screaming at the top of his lungs, Pilate had the title, but Jesus had the testimonies. loved ones, friends, you've got a question today to answer as you continue on life's journey. What's at the end of it all? A title? Or a testimony? That you were a person through whom God created a kingdom, that you fed the hungry, ministered to the poor, ministered to the oppressed in the name of Jesus Christ, that you shared the gospel, that you won the lost? Titles or testimonies? There was never a question in Dale. Oh, he had the title, Reverend Dale Johnson. But that was only a means to an end. He needed to be ordained to become what his mother had prayed for, a pastor. Dale lived from age 18 on a life that was all about telling people about Jesus Christ. It was all about winning the lost. Title or testimony? Dale's life was a testimony of his love for Jesus. Favorite hymn, by the way, was, "Oh, how I love Jesus." It wasn't about titles for Dale. In fact, if he was alive today and in his pre-dementia mind, he might say something like this: "I'm just a nobody who wants to tell everybody about somebody who can save anybody." Now, let me back up just a little bit. I want to explain something. Then I want to use an illustration that Dale used often. It was one of his favorite illustrations. And by the way, I've told people through the years of my ministry that you don't have to listen to anything that I say. You know, I'm just a human being like you. But when God speaks, you better listen. And God speaks to us primarily now through the Scriptures. And the very first words of the Bible tell us that in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. God created the sun, the moon, the stars. He created the lakes and rivers and the birds of the air, the fish of the sea. And then God created man to rule over what he had created. But he saw that it wasn't good for man to be alone, and so he administered the divine anesthetic, as you call it, to him, took a rib off from his side, and he created a woman so that she could be a helpmate, a friend, a companion, a lover. And then God blessed them. And he spent the days walking and talking with the people he had created. In short, life was good. And you say, well, how come the world today is such a mess? How did we get in this situation? What happened to throw everything off? Sin came into the world. Sin poisoned the world. Humans chose to do what God told them not to do. See, that's basically what sin is. Sin is simply disobedience to God. God says, do something, and you don't do it. That's sin. God says, don't do something, and you do it. That's sin. Sin entered the world, and everything changed. You say, well, how did sin enter the world? God had put man and woman in a very idyllic situation. In fact, it's called the Garden of Eden. And he said, you can go anywhere you want. You can do anything you want. Enjoy life. There's just one thing I don't want you to do. And when we do what God tells us not to do, what is that? See? Because they had sinned, God drove them out of the Garden of Eden. See that in Genesis chapter 3. And as a result, humans were separated from God. They were separated from the relationship that they had had with God. Why are humans separated from God and His love? Because of sin. Now listen to this. Isaiah 59:2. Your sins have cut you off from God. And the Bible tells us in Romans 3:23 that all of us have sinned. I've sinned, you've sinned, everyone has sinned. And because of that sin, we are separated from God. There's this gap, there's this huge chasm that separates us from God. 1 Timothy 2:5 tells us God is on one side and all the people are on the other side. And that separation leads to death and certain judgment. Romans 6:23 tells us the wages of sin, the result of sin is death. In Hebrews 9:27, humans are destined to die once, and after that, the judgment. And in 2 Thessalonians, it says, those who do not know God will be punished with everlasting destruction and shut out from the presence of the Lord. But there is a solution. We have good news today. Listen to me now. Jesus Christ, who died on the cross for our sins, is the way to God. 1 Timothy 2:5-6. God is on one side and all the people on the other side. And Christ Jesus, himself man, is between them to bring them together by giving his life for all mankind. 1 Peter 3:18 tells us, God, Christ died for sins once for all to bring you to God. He is the bridge between humans and God. He is the way to God. You say, well, that's great. Does that include everybody? Yes, everybody has that opportunity. But only those who personally receive Jesus Christ into their lives, trusting Him to be their Savior, forgiving their sins, can cross that bridge and be reconciled with God. Listen to this verse. Don't miss this. John 1:12. To all who received Him, meaning Jesus, to those who believe on His name, He gave the right to become the children of God. You say, well, okay, how do you receive Him? Well, God made it very simple. Simple enough so that even a child could understand it. I mean, Dale was 8, I was 10 when we asked Jesus to be our Savior. Did we understand everything? No. I don't understand everything today. But God made it simple enough so that even a child can understand. He made it as simple as ABC. That's what we first learned when we were children. A, we need to acknowledge that we have sinned and that we are in need of a Savior. Well, the Bible says that all of us have sinned. And in Isaiah it says that our sins have separated us from God. There's that sin problem. But in 1 John 1:9 it says that if we confess those sins, He's going to forgive those sins. You know, it's like you've got a computer screen and you've got all your sins here on the screen. Some of you may have to scroll down quite a few times to see all those. But all your sins are on the screen and you ask God to forgive you. And He pushes the divine delete button. And the screen's blank. and your sins are forgiven. That is what separates us from God. So you need to acknowledge that you're a sinner in need of a Savior. B, Acts 16:31 says, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved. Or the most famous verse in the Bible, for God so loved the world, God the Father so loved the world, that he sent his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. So, we need to acknowledge that we are a sinner in need of a Savior. We need to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and see, confess. It says in Romans 10:9, that if we confess with our mouth Jesus is Lord, and believe in our hearts that God has raised him from the dead, we will be saved. Praise God. And once you are saved, God takes care of your past, your present, and your future. Your past sins are forgiven. You have a future hope of eternal life in heaven. And you have the present help of Jesus in your life to make it through the difficult times that we go through in this life. Let's bow for prayer. And while your heads are bowed and your eyes are closed, no one's looking around. If God has spoken to you today, and you want to receive Jesus Christ as your Savior, I'm going to give a prayer, and I want you to just simply repeat that prayer silently right where you are. Father God, I acknowledge that I haven't always done the right thing. Many times I've done things that you don't want me to do. I admit that I've sinned. Today I believe that Jesus came to earth to die for my sins. And that he rose again and he's alive today. I confess my sins to you and ask Jesus to forgive me and be my Savior and the Lord or manager of my life. As best I know how, I give my life to you. While your heads are still bowed and eyes closed, no one's looking around. I'm going to ask a question. Because I'm going to pray for you. I'm not going to have you stand. I'm not going to have you come down the front. But if you have prayed that prayer today, would you simply raise your hand so that I can pray for you? Would you do that right now? God bless you. Yes. Yes. Praise God. Yes. Thank you. You can put your hands down. Father, thank you so much. This is what we prayed for, many of us, that through Dale's funeral, this godly man who loved to share Jesus, that people would come to know you at his funeral. And I thank you for the hands that have been raised, Lord. And pray that you will help them as they begin this new life. They're just infants now, Lord, and they need to grow, and they need to be fed, and help them to get into the Bible, get into a good church, and grow their life now. Lord, I'm so thrilled today for them that they can experience the joys that we have as Christians, as followers of Christ. I pray that you will help them on their way now, Lord, as they begin this new journey with Christ. This I pray in his name. Amen. Following the benediction, the family will be escorted, first of all, out when you take the body out to side, and then we're going to come in. The family will be going to the gym, and after they're dismissed here, you can follow them down the hall. And at 1:30, the family and anyone else who would like to go for the interment will be up at, where is it, Long Lake Lutheran Community Cemetery. Will you please stand this time for the benediction? And Stephanie has asked me to use the benediction that her dad always uses. And now, by the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, rest and abide with you until Jesus returns. Amen.
We have one of those, like, twice that size.
What was he going to say?
He was saying, I should have told him somewhere that my middle name is LaRue after Grandpa.
Right?
And then they were talking about other things they should have said, you know, like Dale and Collins. What do you call those things?
Poof puffs.
Poof puffs. What are they?
Cheese puffs. Popovers. Popovers. At the old grill.
The old grill. The old grill. It has a lot of fruits, so that has to be good.
Just keep it back a little longer.
Get in under the tent, please.
Yeah, you can crowd in.
I'll go behind you.
Let me stand behind you.
Thank you. Okay, yeah, so if you want to come right down in here, perfect. Yeah, just come right down here and maybe face this way. Pastor will want to be on the head in here, so go. A little further down here, Pastor.
I'll block the window.
I'm good.
Okay. All right, here, I'll give it to you. You do it.
In about 20 years, we're all going to look so young in this.
All right.
We're going to close in here. We might spend longer.
We can crowd in a little closer, too.
Me,
if you guys want to come in a little bit.
Oops.
You have to get warmed up.
I said to my wife on the way here, I said, well, I'll either do 10 minutes or 5 or 2, depending on the weather. She said 2. And again, we can laugh.
Right.
Because we celebrate.
Yes. Yep.
And our experience of heaven is in two stages. The first stage is when our bodies go back to the dust in the ground. From dust we came, we formed Adam out of the dust of the ground, and to dust we return. While our non-material part of us that constitutes our essential being goes to heaven to be with God. 2 Corinthians 5:7, absent from the body, present with the Lord. Mm-hmm. The second stage will occur at a future time when our bodies, only our new bodies, will be reunited with our spirits. God put body and soul together in the first place, and he's going to join them together so that we can become the kind of individuals that he desired and designed in the first place. Praise God.
Praise God.
And now with the assurance that Dale Johnson has only left the body for a time to go and be with the Lord. We commit his body to the ground to await the resurrection morning. We comfort ourselves with the assurance that Dale is even now enjoying a beautiful life with his Lord, a life to be made complete when his soul is reunited with his body on that resurrection morning. Once again, let's pray. Our Father in heaven, as we remember Dale Johnson, we thank you for the time that we had together on this earth. We look forward to an eternity of joy and laughter and feasting with him once again. But Lord, while we're here, life is difficult, and we're so thankful that you are with us. We're thankful for the friends that you've provided in the family. And I pray that you will lead Sandra and Stephanie, Eric, Sumner, and Isaac, and Sierra, and the rest of us as we mourn. I pray that you will console us, turn our mourning to joy, give us your grace, and remind us that even though death is part of life, it is only the gateway to eternal life. Father, fill us with your hope. Guide us from this day to feel your strength and your peace. And now, the benediction that Dale said so often. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with you until Jesus comes.
Amen.
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 Yes.
Had to look. Come on.
I feel like I'm holding a little everyone else here.
Mom, I
come on.
She's got it on.
No, no, no.
The
leg go right to snow bank.
You know, you have the belt with it. Oh, I don't remember that one.
At least it's all once.
All right, so it's not just me. We're all looking.
Yeah, I want to see.
It's pretty amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah. What's that? You know.
Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me.
Oh, Paulette, do you love Jesus? Oh,
yes, I love Jesus.
Are you sure you love Jesus?
I'm sure I love Jesus.
Tell us why you love Jesus.
Because he first loved
me.
Oh, how I love Jesus.
Oh, I love Jesus.
Oh, how I love Jesus. Jesus, because he first loved me.
Oh, that's just the corpse. It was kind of one of those leaves you could go on and on.
I did that around.
Yes, you could do around them. Because if you did the other part, there is a name I love to hear. I love to sing its word. It sounds like music in my ear. The sweetest name on earth. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me.
Wow.
When Stephanie was sick, I can remember taking turns one time in the bedroom, holding our rocker. And we were singing that song, humming it, humming it.
Kind of repeat the
It was like a medley, you know, what we used to call sensory.
Sorry.
Oh, we know when you go from one song into another.
Oh.
I love sensory.
Steel toes. Oh yeah.
That's great.
They go up that way and then
and
over to 65 and then up
that
against
it. Yeah.
And then go like right here.
Oh,
yeah. <it's so cool. laughs>
I feel like you're messing up the leather.
Well, we have lots and lots of good memories.
Yeah, you can.
Steph, Ron is coming off.
Yes, yes. I'm so glad. Hey, Bergie.
Hi.
Let him get under the tent.
Yeah, get him in.
Let him get under the tent.
Get him under the tent.
Get him in here.
Come on in here.
Yes.
Hi, Sandra.
How do you know my last name?
I said what?
Yeah, how do you know?
Husband, my buddy.
Yes.
Best man in the wedding.
Oh.
Yeah, I remember that.
We worked at Dayton's, went to Northwestern and everything together.
And he introduced you to Mona.
Yeah.
And I stayed
at his farm. I'd stay at the farm.
Nice friend.
Yeah. Yeah, I'd say. They'd say, hey, Dale, are you going up? He had the big car D that took the big motors for the elevators.
Uh-huh.
And they said, Dale, are you going up? Sometimes I said that. He said, amen. We had so much fun together. Hunting, fishing, flying in the Mercedes at the state fair there.
Sweetheart, this is Sue's and his daughter Stephanie.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
He knows. Oh, did he? I didn't know if he was in this.
Did you? Yes. These are my kids.
Oh, hi. Oh.
Sierra and Isaac.
I'm Isaac.
Yeah.
Sumner. Sierra and Sumner.
And Sumner.
Sierra. And Kathy back there, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, what we got over here?
Okay.
I'm Nikki. I've been Stephanie's best friend since kindergarten.
Oh, is that right?
And she sang with Stephanie today? Nikki did.
And that's
what
Melissa,
a day that will be.
My other best friend.
We were in kindergarten too.
And her husband Tom.
Oh, yeah?
And Don. Know her since I was 5 too.
All right. I'm not trying to.
Excuse me.
No, I was
showing the camera.
No, I was. I want to ask you about this though. I was telling the kids this morning. Wouldn't you guys say watch your lights when you'd be done at Dayton's?
Yeah. Yeah.
And I thought, wouldn't that be a cool thing to say at the end after the prayer?
Yeah.
Say watch your lights.
We can say that as we leave today.
I was singing along a little bit.
Aww.
Oh, how I love Jesus.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I
love that.
Yeah. Well,
yeah, you guys have
12 and a half years, I'll be 100 years old.
Wow.
I just turned 87 July 4th.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah.
Wow.
4th of July guy. So.
Well, you get fireworks every year on your birthday.
Oh, man, yeah. 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 Yeah, I will. You used to teach my Sunday school. I was only 8. And every week you would say a prayer before the class would start. And one day when you said that prayer, I ask Jesus in my heart. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am a life that was changed. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am so glad you came.
pictures made you cry. You didn't have much money, but you gave it anyway. Jesus took the gift you gave, and that's why I'm here today.
What it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. day comes and I find myself standing in the sun, I can only imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine, yeah. I can only imagine. To my knees, will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus?
Much money, but you gave it anyway.
that's why I'm here today. Imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when all I us forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine, yeah. I can only imagine. To my knees, will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? Or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Worship you. I can only imagine.